So, oh, you're following me already. That's great, ladies and gentlemen. May I introduce Dr. Sarah Wood from Unruly is with us.
Hi, everyone. Hi.
You are our first prophet for today, and we give you 5 minutes.
5 minutes, yeah.
Is that all right?
That's perfect.
Short presentation, a few questions, and then we have the first look into the future. Sarah Wood is co-founder and co-CEO from Unruly. It's all yours, please.
Where's clicker? Where's presentation?
Right here. Da,
da, perfect.
Here we go.
Awesome. Okay, cheers. Hey, everyone. I can't believe there's so many people here. This is insane. Okay, so the first thing I want to talk about and predict is the next 12 months are going to be filled with uncertainty. It's going to be the watchword for the next 12 months. Trump or Clinton, boom or bust, emerging technologies, tragic mass migration, the fallout from Brexit. In terms of geopolitical spectrum, we've never had a climate quite this uncertain. It's the same in our ad industry, right? Emerging technologies, lots of different ways of buying each other's products, new partnerships, new opportunities, but new threats. So what does that mean? What does that mean for how we need to approach predicting the future? So what I think it means is, more than ever, it's less about whether you are on the buy side or the sell side, whether you're a creative producer or whether you're an ad tech vendor. It's about how are you as a person? Are you a glass half full or are you a glass half empty person? Because these personal perspectives are going to shape the way that we think about our industry over the coming months, and they're going to shape the type of industry that we create. So with my glass half empty, I could stand here and predict data lockdown. Going to be a lot of attention around data privacy. A tsunami of legislation coming at us. Ad blocking up. Such an erosion of consumer trust. Consumers voting with their clicks, voting with their thumbs, installing ad blockers. All of us planning our post-advertising careers. Death of the open web. What happens when the ad-funded internet is no more? When there is no more free thinking, free speaking, messy, gloriously messy and creative internet? Well, that would be the pessimistic view. That would be your Elliot from Mr. Robot, full of angst, full of anxiety about the future. But I don't believe that. Yeah, our future hasn't been written yet. As said by the great Doc Brown, no one's has. Your future is whatever you make it. And having spoken to so many people here over the last 48 hours, I'm really confident and optimistic when I stand here with my glass half full, not half empty, and talk about some of the following trends. Okay. So here we go. Politer ads. I don't see ad blocking as a threat over the coming months. I see it as the biggest opportunity for positive change in our industry. This is going to be the year when more brands, more publishers adopt politer ad formats. We're seeing the end of flash this year. I think we're going to see the end of forced pre-roll next year. We're all waking up to the fact that consumers do not want to be shouted at. They do not want to be interrupted. And we can all do something about that. We're going to see more purposeful brands. If you think about ad blocking being an existential threat to publishers, media titles, then you have a whole rise of Gen Z, so the younger generation of consumers coming up, and along with them a bunch of challenger brands, unknown brands, brands without brands, who are super authentic, full of purpose and authenticity. What we're going to see next year, over the next 12 months, are successful brands, big brands, waking up to this threat and really rethinking what they're there for. So I would say to any brand that wants to be here in 5, 10 years' time, what is your purpose? What value do you bring to the world? What is your higher purpose? What are you going to do to change the world? Because these are the brands that are going to succeed, and we're going to see their marketing amplifying the good work that they're doing and the purpose that they bring to the table. Stronger together. This is not a plug for Hillary, but this is what I imagine over the next 12 months we're going to see. The future, in a moment of uncertainty, can be a formidable foe. Now, we're stronger together. So if we pool our audiences, bigger audiences, more valuable audiences, if we can pool our data sets, more valuable data, we're going to see big companies buying more small companies, not just to future-proof their own technologies, but to bring in those extra skills that are so desperately needed. And one of the big challenges we face is the skills shortage. So this is where it's not just going to be about acqui-hires, we're going to see more diversity in our industry. So 2017 is going to be the year when we see more female leaders. We already have incredible women working across our industry, and we're going to see more women making it to the top, more female creative directors, more female CEOs, more female CTOs, because together, as companies, we are more innovative, we make better decisions, and we've got a stronger future. So here's a few things that I didn't talk about, but I could have. So could have talked about virtual reality, augmented reality, mixed reality, Internet of Things, the advent of things. These things are all coming. But as with all predictions, it's about the timing. We all know they're coming. It's so difficult to predict whether 2017 will be the year that they cross the chasm and become mainstream. And that is why I think the key to success, the best strategy for success in an age of uncertainty, is agility. We need to be open to new ideas. We need to keep listening, keep reading, keep learning, keep experimenting, keep being agile, because that is the only way that we as an industry are going to be able to keep being at the cutting edge of shaping our culture. And if we're really brave, if we work really hard to work together to do our best work, if we commission campaigns that want to change the status quo, and if we work together collaboratively, then I think we will shape that better future. We won't just shape a stronger future for the advertising industry. With all the power that we have and all the ability to reach billions of people around the world, we will be able to have a massive impact on the whole world we live in. And that is the 2017 that I'm looking forward to seeing. Thank you.
That kind of looks okay. All right, good luck. Yeah,
you bet. Mm-hmm. So, do you just one question? Because I know in your near future you have a plane going to London, so you're actually on the way to the taxi, all right? What is it what you take back from the DMEXCO what maybe is an impact for the future?
So I think for me, I've been incredibly inspired by the new halls, motion and experience, and the blossoming, the flourishing of so many small companies. So I feel like there's a lot of innovation, and there's a lot of willingness to cooperate. So lots of big agencies, big companies, they're in the startup village talking to these small companies, and that gives me great hope.
Prophet number one, Sarah,
thank you so much.
And thanks, hurry guys. Up, you're going to get this plane. Thank you so much.
Cheers.
Next in the line, our next prophet, please welcome from OWL, the head of media sales. This is Jim Norton, ladies and gentlemen. Here's the clicker.
All right. Well, first of all, thanks to everybody for making it to the last stage event of the conference. And I want to, I should call something out. As head of sales, I should probably change the spelling of profit to P-R-O-F-I-T. I think that would be more appropriate for a sales guy. But let's just talk about a couple of things, starting with consumers. And really what we're showing here, and if you look at these statistics that have come out of a recent Forrester survey, we are not doing a good job. 74% of ads annoying, 93% waiting for content, slow load times. And if you look at these statistics, it just says that we as an industry need to do a better job. When we are not doing a good job, what happens is the ads that are paying for the content get blocked. And studies show today that in some cases, more than one in four ads is now being blocked. And that's much higher in many cases around Europe. So what this says is we've got to change the way we are thinking. The way we're thinking about content, the way we're thinking about technology, and certainly the way that we're thinking about advertising. Really what it's about is engaging with consumers on their terms. And you know what it is we are all consumers. Many of us are folks that are blocking ads. Many of us are folks frustrated with slow load times. Many of us are frustrated with the data depletion from heavy advertising. And really what this is about is rethinking how we are engaging with consumers. And the way that we're looking at it at AOL is really a three-pronged approach. And we start with empathy. And really what empathy is emotion. And it's really about creating content that connects with the consumers on an emotional level. It's really turning awareness into advocacy. And when you make that slight change of awareness to advocacy, that's what allows brands to show their true DNA. So really think about that empathy as emotion. Secondly, programmatic, probably the most overused buzzword of the last 5 years. But really what programmatic is the ability to deliver empathetic messages using data and being able to do it at scale. So certainly it's the right message at the right time, on the right device, to the right individual. But that's about data. And really what programmatic has become is the activation of unique data assets. And then lastly, realities. And what realities are immersive advertising experiences that draw on that emotion. And so if you think about virtual reality or augmented reality or 360, artificial intelligence, using all of these brand new technologies to create these immersive ad experiences that drive emotion, that drive empathy, but then being able to deliver it efficiently at the right place, to the right audience, and doing that through a scaled programmatic platform. So at AOL, we're very much on our way to activating on this three-pronged approach. First, when we talk about empathy, we just released a study prior to the Demexco conference around content moments. And we've identified 8 moments of content that users experience when they are online. And so it could be wanting to be inspired, wanting to feel good, wanting to be in the know. And what we've been able to do is look to say specific audiences at specific times crave specific content moments. If you're a potential automotive buyer, somebody that is in the market for a new automobile, being able to say that these are people that are craving content that inspires them and puts them in the know. So when you know the type of content, that is where you can draw the empathy, you can draw the emotion. Secondly is with the programmatic. And now at AOL, which also includes Microsoft advertising, and soon to include Yahoo advertising, more than 50% of our advertising is now being run programmatically. And that is really built on the data assets that we have. As many of you know, we were acquired last year by Verizon, and the unique carrier-level data sets that come from a giant telco like Verizon really make programmatic possible at a way that had not been done before. And then lastly, we invested in a company, made an acquisition of a company called Riot. This is the largest 360 virtual reality news network in the world. And to be able to take the expertise that Riot has in creating content in a VR or an AR environment and apply that at the brand level to produce those immersive experiences. So in summary, driving empathy, doing it with data at scale, and doing it in immersive formats. So with that, I say thank you.
That was quick. Just 2 questions.
Yes.
One looking back, one looking into the future. What are you taking with you from the Demexco, thinking about the last 2 days?
I think the innovation in ad formats, and I saw some amazing demonstrations while on the floor, the ability to not only create an immersive experience, but being able to simplify it on behalf of the advertiser or agency. Being able to take a 30-second commercial produced for television, and the ability to quickly convert that into, with that single asset, convert that into a highly immersive video ad experience on a mobile device.
And the look into the future, who's going to be looking at all the industry right here? Who's going to be in trouble in 5 years, and who's going to be successful?
Well, look, I think we're all in trouble as publishers, certainly, if we don't act on the statistics that we showed. We've got to do a better job of creating better advertising experiences for consumers. Advertising is the great enabler of the publishing community today. And if we're not doing a good job on the advertising, all of us as publishers are in trouble.
And who's going to be successful?
AOL, Yahoo, Microsoft.
How's okay. Have a seat right here. Stay with us, please. Thank you so much. And we got our third prophet, and thanks for keeping up the speed. That's great. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the CEO and founder of Hootsuite. Here is Ryan Holmes on the stage. Ryan,
thank you.
So good to have you.
Thank you. It's great to be here today, and great to see so many people still in the audience. My name is Ryan Holmes, and pleasure to be here. I'm the CEO of Hootsuite, which is the world's largest platform for the management of social media. I'm giving 3 quick predictions today. I decided not to talk about Forrester's recent prediction that 6% of people will be replaced by robots in 2025. Decided not to talk about Uber self-driving car fleet launching in Philadelphia today. We live in really amazing times. I'm going to talk about three things that are relevant to entrepreneurs and to, I think, our industry of marketing and advertising. So to start off with, for entrepreneurs, sustainability over hypergrowth. There's been a lot of paper unicorns over the last few years, and I know that Europeans tend to focus on more profitability in their business than high growth, and so they may be smugly grinning at this, knowing that they were right, and that businesses now are focusing more and more on sustainability, lower growth, yet higher cash neutrality or cash positive nature. We put a mission out in our company over the last year to maintain cash positive this year, and we have achieved that, and I think that will become a trend that we'll see more and more of. The second trend, and it's nice to see Jim's deck as well, and he talked to this, but personalized customer journey at scale. And I'll share a quick story about this. So there are four big trends that we are all seeing that are changing the customer journey and our relationship with customers. Mobile, everybody has mobile in their pocket. They have a personal computer there, and we all know that this is absolutely changing the relationship. Social is helping content be transmitted globally at high velocity, and ultimately real time is also affecting things. This is the Uber, the Airbnbs of the world that are changing how we interact with businesses. And then finally, Generation C. I know everybody's heard of millennials. For those of you that haven't heard of Generation C, I really love this concept. It is the connected consumer. It is people that do use mobile, social, and real time, and it is age agnostic. It is about your relationship with the internet and the cloud. And these four trends are really shaping our relationship with our customers. So a quick story, a personal story about Roomba. Who, anybody see or know this video? Cat on a Roomba wearing a shark costume chasing a duck. I watched this a couple of years ago. Obviously the best thing for a CEO to be spending his time on. And I thought the video was funny, but you know, more importantly, I saw it through social. And I was interested in the product, interested in Roomba. And so I went into an evaluation phase. I asked my friends on social if they had a Roomba and if they liked it, and I got a ton of responses back. So that was my evaluation. I went into acquisition, I bought a Roomba, I shared it on Instagram. And then I had an engagement moment. I got home one day and my Roomba had got caught in my Christmas tree lights. There was a huge mess all around my house. There were pine needles on the floor. And I took a photo and I just said, bad robot, and I tagged Roomba in it. I just thought it was funny and I wasn't really looking for more than that. But an interesting engagement happened. The company that manages or owns Roomba, it's called iRobot, and that's their brand on social. And we had a conversation. They said they saw that the Roomba had been bad and that they were going to send me a brand new Roomba. And I thought they were maybe, you know, joking or whatever, but they came through with it and they sent me a brand new Roomba. And so I then became a huge advocate of Roomba and iRobot. This is a picture of my new upgraded model of Roomba with my dog, and it you know, a thank you to them. And I guess that advocacy continues to this day, so both online and in real life. So that's a personal journey, but my prediction is that smart brands are going to figure out how to do this at scale. I don't think the iRobot example is scalable very well, but how can we scale this? How can we create and help with triage the interactions like this at scale? If you are a telco, if you are an airline, managing this at scale is not feasible in the way that iRobot was managing it. And so I think with AI over the next while, we will start to triage and help to really manage this at scale for brands. My final prediction, a top secret opportunity for all the brands out there in the room, it's an unleveraged channel, and this is called employee advocacy. So you remember the four big trends, think about these in your organizations, mobile, social, real-time, and Generation C, which includes a lot of millennials that have their phones in their pockets. So I want to take a brand that everybody knows, McDonald's. They have 66 million followers on fans on Facebook. They have 3.29 million fans on Twitter. It gives them an effective reach of around 70 million. If the algorithm doesn't filter content getting to those fans and followers. So what is the hidden opportunity here? McDonald's has 1.9 million employees plus global. Each of those employees has, on average, 200 friends on Facebook and around 61 fans on Twitter. The effective reach there, 495 million. It's about a 7x increase on their brand reach. So a huge opportunity for brands to think about how they can get their employees engaged, how they can get their employees to become advocates of the content that they put out. We all are doing paid advertising and social. We're all doing organic, but we really need to think about leveraging this. The algorithms do favor face-to-face and peer-to-peer content. Word-of-mouth content is very powerful, as we all know. And so my prediction is that we will see more of this over the next few years. And that sums it up. Say hi to me on Twitter. Thank you.
Thanks for this quick and powerful presentation. What's the next big thing after social media?
Well, you know, I mentioned the self-driving cars, the AI. You know, I think that those are AI is going to absolutely play into social media, though. The triage at scale will be huge, and helping service customers and interactions there and in using AI is going to be a big part of where brands go.
We had great CEOs today here in the Congress. So, for example, the CEO of Nestle, to mention just one. What about control of brands and social media? Is there anything which will change, or is it just a place where no control is possible for the brands?
I mean, that's what we do. We help brands control social media at scale. So we help with multiple teams, multiple workflows, multiple brand accounts on multiple social networks. That's a very complex problem that brands have to figure out. And when you apply, you know, regionality to that, it becomes a huge complex problem. Compliance, workflow, all of these things do make it complex. And brands do need to have control. For FINRA compliance industries, they face legal consequences if they don't stay on top of it.
Your personal future, you're going to go where now? You go back to London, to New York, where you go?
I just came from our office in London. I'm now, I'm sticking around until tomorrow. I'm going to miss the rush, and then I'm going to hop on a plane back to Vancouver, where we're headquartered.
Well, it's not so bad. Ladies and gentlemen, thanks to our prophets, and thanks to you for joining us at this last session. And it would be great if you want to, you can stay, because we're doing now a very personal thing. Christian Much is with us.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Mr. Demex.
That wasn't planned like this. That one, Jim, thanks very much. Because and I would like to ask you just to stay one more minute, because like in the last few years, I would like to welcome our team, or just a part of our team, because they deserve a big applause from you guys. They are, you know, working 12 months ahead and behind the scene, or most of them. And I think we should welcome them and give them a big applause for all the work and the great success of this year's Demexco. And I would like to thank you for coming and to stay as long, and hope that you're all back. And I would like to ask the team to join the stage.
Come out!
As well as the moderators from the other halls. Please come out. Where are you? Come on.
Thanks for staying a little bit, just 5 minutes.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Wolfram.
Go in the front.
Come on, everybody. Thank you.
Come on, join us here, please. Come on, the prophet's in the middle. Come on.
And here's one more thing. You know, we always have to wait till the end. We can announce the number of visitors we had this year. And so it's the eighth year in a row that we can announce a new record. We've hit the 50,000 level. We would like to thank you for 50,700 visitors this year. Woo! Thank you.
Come in the middle, Yeah, of course. Christian, please go into the middle.
Why that?
Yeah, because, why? I have no idea why, but please do it.
Ja, komm in die Mitte.
come over here because we need a, this is something for a silver frame, you know, for eternity, for eternity. So, come over here, so, no, just go in the back, no problem. So here's the camera, and then, at least, we're going to shout one word, it's called D-Mexico, yeah? Okay, and you're going to do it with us, because this is a little thank you for 12 months, 24/7. This is a great, great work. You did the best digital conference ever, and the hottest, by the way. Thank you. One, two, three. Hey! This is like a usual day begins at Moro family.